Hi, everybody. Julie Goodnight here again. And I hope you're coming on board with me. Had a little technical difficulties there. I see one person popping up. And so sorry for the rough start there. Hopefully everybody will jump back on and join us. Again, I'm Julie Goodnight, coming at you live today with another daily dose of horsemanship homework. And I have been posting every single day of the shutdown, which began early here in the great state of Colorado, with our super proactive governor. We have actually, I think this is now our fifth week of shutdown, fourth week of strict stay-at-home orders. So, yeah, you know, oddly, thanks, Dove, for joining me this morning from Florida, right? Ocala? Yeah, the previous connection I was attempting with my computer, and no can do, apparently. So I, you know, when all else fails, revert back to your telephone. So coming at you live from my phone now. And so thank you guys for joining me. I see the numbers are rapidly rising. So we're getting a good crowd this morning. So appreciate it. As I said, I have been posting live every day of the shutdown. I don't know. I gave up counting the number of lessons we've done, but I have done a horsemanship homework lesson for you every single day of this shutdown. And good morning, Peggy. Good morning, Megan and Elizabeth. Thank you guys for jumping back on. Sorry for that false start. I tell you, that live producer, it just doesn't seem to work. At least not for me. Christine from Buffalo, New York. I hope you guys are riding out the storm there well. Dove, you're from Gulf Breeze outside of Pensacola. Okay, you're a coastal girl. I like that. And Vicky from Missouri, thank you guys for joining me. So, let's see, it's been, I believe it was last Wednesday, the last time we did a live post. And, good morning, Norma Kay. My service is horrible. Trade-offs for living in the boonies. Yeah, I hear ya. You know, I own and we run an internet-based business, and we live in the boonies too, and I'm telling you, it is a constant hassle, if only for broadband service. But right now, I'll take what we can get. Actually, it normally works quite well. It's just all the overload going on now with all the kids home from school and everybody home from work and everybody working from home. So that's just life the way it is. Good morning, Chrissy from Georgia. I guess it's not morning there or anymore. And Washington, so we've got people on both ends of the coast now. Becky from Northern California. So it's been quite a few days since I came at you guys live, and I was really yearning for this connection again. You guys make me laugh at your jokes, so keep them coming. And I really enjoy candidly answering your questions and getting those real-time, real-life questions. I want to come back to Georgia and do a clinic. Find me a place to do a clinic. I'm very available these days. So, hi from Virginia. And a couple of people from Virginia, thanks for joining in. And good morning from Montana. Laurel, so got a great crowd here this morning. So I want you guys to start answering, or not answering, I'll answer. You ask questions for me. And I am going to try to stay on this live post until I've answered every one of your questions. And so I just want to go over some of the lessons I've done for you in the past 5 days. Now, Kathy, right before we got cut off from the first post, Kathy was telling me this is the first time she's joined a live post, but she's gone back and watched every single daily dose homework lesson. Now, when should we use spurs? Let me just write that down, Dove. When should you use spurs? I'm going to answer that question in just a second. The questions are going by so fast. I'm having trouble keeping up with them. And, you know, this is a very not a good situation for an ADD person, which I'm actually not. But I'm highly distracted by all the stuff floating by on the screen. I'll get back to your question about Spurs. I just want to sort of remind you guys. Hello from British Columbia. Got some Canadian friends joining us today. Thank you. And West Virginia, nice, Mike, hello. So in the last 5 or 6 days since I came at you live with a post, we have, good morning, Helen from UK. Thanks for joining us evening there, I guess, or late afternoon. And Southern Alberta, so we're getting good representation from our Canadian friends over the northern border. Thanks for joining us. Grazing muzzles and slow feeders. Good question. Just writing that down. Okay. So just to review the lessons over the last 5 days, I did 3 more lessons with Woodrow. Now we've kind of gotten into a routine with Woodrow. You might have noticed in an effort to, be able to take a little bit of a break on some days, I have recorded some of the arena lessons in advance. And so what we've been doing with Woodrow is Mel brings him over to my house on Fridays mornings, and we just spend the morning working with Woodrow. And we generally do film a lesson, give him a little break, film another lesson, give him a little break, and film a third one. And one thing I've learned about Woodrow is that third lesson is a tough one, because he just has a short window, even though he's a 3-year-old, before he doesn't like being bossed around anymore. And so although we didn't see as much of a temper tantrum on the third lesson this week as we did the week before, I still saw that tantruming behavior coming out with him. But the important thing is it's getting better and better and better. He's a super fun horse to work with in spite of his little mental challenges that he has, in that he's just a little bit bossy. He's a very ADD horse. He's very high-headed, always looking around, you know, always busy-minded. And he's kind of dominant, so... and he's got a temper. So all of those make him a challenge to handle, but he's smart as a whip and he learns lightning fast. And if you can make things fun for him, he's a super fun horse to train. So I had 3 lessons with him. One was a review of rating speed, where he threw the big giant tantrum the week before. And I, wanted to see, number one, did he retain the lesson of rating speed? And number two, did he associate it with the tantruming in any way? And he did brilliantly on that lesson. And so then the next lesson we did was on ground tying, taking that one step further. And he did okay on that. Not his best subject, but he did just fine. And then the third lesson we did was on the walk to trot transition in hand. And he did great on that, except for as that lesson went on, he kind of got increasingly agitated and kind of got a little bit where he was wanting to throw a little tantrum again. But we pushed through that and we had a good day. So that was what I did with lessons with Woodrow. If you have questions about them or if you have just general questions, that's fine. And then I also did 2 lessons with my sweet little mare, Annie. Mm-hmm. A little quarter horse mare, and I showed you, I showed you the pulley rein on Annie, which is the emergency stopping rein, and then I also showed you how to use the indirect rein in front of the withers to move the shoulder of the horse. Oh, I think we also did the circling exercise into the pivot. So I'm going to go back and start reading your questions now. And those are the ground, I believe those are the arena lessons that we've done since the last live post. So I'm just going to scroll back up here. until I get to Dove's question. Andrea's, gosh, all kinds of people coming on board. So good to hear from you guys. So nice to connect. Yeah, we've broken the 100 people barrier. Okay, here we are. Back to the beginning of your questions now. So type, if you have a question or comment, type it out. I'm going to get to it eventually as I scroll down now. And I'm just going to start answering your questions just sort of spontaneously, so these won't be planned or scripted answers, but that's all right. So Dove is asking, when should you use spurs? To me, spurs are an advanced aid for an advanced rider on an advanced horse. It is not an aid for a lazy horse. I don't think spurs are a good tool for a lazy horse. I think, we have to analyze the source of that problem to know the best solution. But generally, that is a lack of authority. That is a lack of reinforcement and follow through on a cue. Laziness is. I prefer to temporarily use a crop to reinforce the cue on a lazy horse. I want my horse to move well off my leg without the spur. But as we train particularly higher level performance horses, and we are looking for minute responses and sharp responses, and I think a lot about what I'm doing when I'm riding, because that's what helps me become a better teacher. But I can tell you, for every one thing that I would teach you to do on a horse, I'm probably doing 100 more things that I'm not even aware of. And I tend to ride in tune with a horse, as pretty much all high-level professional trainers do. It's not me. But riding at that level, you're constantly refining and adjusting your aids to get the slightest change in a horse, in that maneuver and in that response or whatever it is you're working on. And so the spur is a tool of refinement to me. And I don't like to see, certainly not beginner riders or intermediate riders, and I don't like spurs being used as a tool for a lazy horse. I just don't think it's the right tool for that. So thanks for asking that great question. You guys probably noticed that I have spurs on my riding boots. I only wear my boots for riding, and the spurs are always there because I'm too lazy to take them on and off. I would go to the trouble to take them off if I were riding a horse that I thought could not handle an inadvertent touch of the spur, but I can tell you, after a lifetime of riding, I'm pretty good at when I use the spur and when I don't. So, and that is why the spur is not a tool for a beginner or intermediate rider, because you have to have really excellent control of your leg, your entire leg at all times, to be able to wear any kind of spur with a horse. Okay, let's scroll on down here and let's see, the next question I saw had to do with grazing muzzles and slow feeders. Okay, look, when it comes to feeding horses, it is so incredibly regional and local and situational that it's almost hard to have this kind of discussion about it. I wish I lived somewhere where there was so much grass that we had to muzzle our horses. But the truth is, we live in the high desert. The only grass that grows at all is irrigated grass, and we have a very difficult time managing it. Our horses are never strictly on grass. They always eat hay because there's never enough grass. And when there is green grass, it's only for 2 or 3 months. And so it's going to be short-lived. So I don't personally, I've never used a muzzle on a horse. I guess no opinion about them. I will tell you this, when it comes to all things nutrition, I follow Dr. Judith Getty, G-E-T-T-Y. She's got a website. She's got a newsletter. I get her newsletter, and she writes articles every month, and she's practical, down to earth, no nonsense, equine nutritionist. And she has written a lot about grazing muzzles. I know there's a lot of parts of the country where green grass is problematic. For us in the high desert, that's a joke. So anyway, but that even that can vary. I mean, just a neighboring farm could be on a river bottom situation and have too much grass. So I do know that there are concerns about frustration in horses that are muzzled. I think you definitely need to look at, you know, controlling the weight of the horse some way. Look, obesity did not used to be a problem in horses. It was not. All of these diseases in horses that are associated with obesity weren't really around when I was a kid, because there weren't obese horses, because everybody rode their horses hard. Everybody used horses. So obesity is sort of a modern day problem. To me, it parallels that same epidemic in human society, and for the same reasons. And so I think we have to manage in every means possible. And if that includes a muzzle and a slow feeder, go for it. I have used slow feeders. And again, every feeding situation is different. Often years, most years, we feed off big bales. I'm talking about bales of hay that weigh more than 1,000 pounds, where the one flake of hay is, you know, like 5 feet by 5 feet wide. And so you know, different kinds of slow feeders are appropriate for different situations. So I'm sorry, that's the best advice I can give you. I would use any tool you can to manage diabetes in your horses. However, all of our horses free feed hay. They always have hay in front of them. So I'm fortunate in that we can find high quality, low protein grass hay. And so yeah, do they get fat in the summer when the grass is green? You betcha. We try to ride the fat off of them. And that's the time of year when we're riding harder anyway. So hopefully that's what's going on. Look, most people that I talk to that have horses with an obesity problem are still giving that horse grain. Horses do not need concentrated feed unless they're having trouble keeping their weight up or are being just worked so hard that they need the energy. So maybe analyze your feed program. Talk to an equine nutritionist. All right, let's see. That's the only two questions I wrote down. So I'm going to... Gloriana Hoff from Washington. Good to hear from you. I've had you in clinics before. Look forward to coming back to Washington State to do some more clinics. Look, you guys, I can't wait to get back on the road and start traveling again. I suspect it will be strictly for horsemanship clinics. I don't think we're going to jump right back into having large expos for a while. Whenever we do, I'll be there. But I'd love to start doing some clinics. I'm eager to get back on the road. I miss the clinics that I've had to cancel. So if you have a place that you think would be good for hosting me for a clinic, be sure to contact my office and let me know. We'll try to get something scheduled. So hello from the UK. Good morning from Alberta. Okay, there's a question about slow muzzle, slow feeders. And Paradise, California. Diana, thanks for joining us again. Andrea, just got back from the dentist. Lucky you. At least the dentist is working. I hope it wasn't an emergency. And Virginia and India. Gwareg, thank you for joining us so much from India. And I believe you might be our first visitor from India on these live posts. So thanks so much for joining. And I would love to answer a question. Donna from Maine. Bellington, Washington. Absolutely do a clinic there anytime you can schedule me one. And Diana has posted the link to all of my daily doses of horsemanship homework that we've done in the past month. I'm certain that we're above the 30-day mark now in the posting that we've been doing. There's lots of lessons for you there. If any single one of you has done every single lesson, I will be shocked. And if you have, I want to hear about it. And I know a lot of you are stuck at home and you are separated from your horses. And this is a terrible thing. And I am so sorry. And I know it must be, on top of everything else, just some added anxiety you wish you didn't have. You know what? Your horses are going to be fine. They're being taken care of just as well now as they were before. He will miss his interaction with you. And I think we're going to get back to that really soon. And you will pick up right where you left off with your horse. Horses don't regress in their knowledge and training from a lack of handling. What regresses horses in their training is poor handling. What regresses horses in their training is someone riding them or handling them from the ground and doing bad horsemanship with them, teaching the horse bad tricks, teaching the horse or scaring the horse or worrying the horse in ways they shouldn't. So your horse is going to be there when you're ready to get back. In the meantime, you've got all those daily doses to think about. So, question: two hands in a curb bit used to be a huge no-no and still is not allowed in most shows. Why are people riding and teaching students using two hands and a curb bit? Doesn't that defeat the how a curb works? No. Now, that is actually a great question, and there's a good answer for it. So, back in the day, curb bits were all one piece. They all pretty much looked exactly the same because the manufacturing capabilities and the design capabilities back then were minimal. And so bits were, I don't know how the standard curb bit was made, but it was like stamped out in one piece, two shanks, a mouthpiece with a little port, and that was it. And that was what everybody rode in if they didn't ride in a Tom Thumb. And so a curb bit that is all one piece, you should ride only one-handed in, because any movement of any rein causes the entire bit to move in the mouth. Modern bits, and all of the bits I use, which are all Myler bits, they're curb bits, so they have shanks. So they got a mouthpiece, and then they got shanks hanging down. But the shanks articulate. So the bit is actually comprised of multiple pieces of metal, highly designed and engineered and fitted together in such a way that I could move this finger and cause a slight little effect just on that side of the horse's mouth in the curb bit, or I could do it just this way and ask that horse to lift his shoulder just on that side in a curb bit, because of the highly designed and engineered way these bits are made today. Not all curb bits are made that way, but certainly most modern bits used in performance. So the question is, you can ride, here's one more sort of fallacy in the one-handed, two-handed thing. You should never ride one-handed in a snaffle. The snaffle is made for two-handed, direct pressure riding. And so when you bring the reins together in one hand, it's squeezing and kind of causing that jointed bit to clamp around the jaw of the horse. So the snaffle should never be ridden one-handed and should always be ridden two-handed. The curb bit can be ridden one-handed or two-handed as long as the shanks articulate, allowing you to work one side of the horse's mouth than the other. So another reason that we are able to use bits differently today is because of how highly engineered they are with different shapes in the mouth, length of shanks, all kinds of different things that cause different effects on the horse. So, for instance, I might use the 36 Myler curb bit because I have a horse that doesn't break at the pole very easily. And that bit is specifically designed with the port positioned in such a way that it encourages the horse to break at the pole. Another horse I wouldn't use that bit on because he overbreaks at the pole. So there's all kinds of different mouthpieces. I talked before about the 33, the Myler 33 curb bit, which is what I use on my horses, which is a very kindly shaped ergonomic mouthpiece. So anyway, things have really advanced and gotten more modern in that regard. So you absolutely can use two handed on a curb bit as long as the bits, as long as the shanks articulate. You are correct that in most rule books, not all, but in most rule books, if you are riding in a curb bit, you must ride one-handed in a very specific rein hold that relates to the kind of rein you're using. So that those are just a matter of technicalities of the rule book. So thanks, Becky. That was a great question. Thanks for asking it. Okay, Melanie, what confidence builders do you suggest for a not young anymore injured in a horse accident rider who I believe has some PST? Well, okay. That's a great question, and I have a lot of resources for you. First of all, we have recently, I've just started producing, believe it or not, in no relationship whatsoever to the COVID situation. We have, my staff and I have been working on developing horsemanship short courses where you receive, you purchase the course and it has four assignments for you to do, videos to watch, articles to read, worksheets to fill out, and actual exercises for you to do with your horse or information for you to study. And the first short course that we did has just been released and it's selling like hotcakes, and it's called Build Your Confidence with Horses. And I think Diana will throw us a link up for that. And Build Your Confidence with Horses will talk just about this very subject, getting back to horses. Look, when your fear is coming from an actual incident, we call that post-traumatic stress or post-traumatic fear, at, because it is tied to a specific incident. And there's a lot to know about that. First and foremost, that you have fear memories that are in your brain. They're indelibly placed there. You can never remove them, so you need to learn to manage them. All of this is in the short course. Also, on my website, if you just search confidence, you will find many, many articles and resources on the free side of my website having to do with confidence. So I encourage you to check that out. And also, I did a major lesson on building confidence as a living room lesson, as a daily dose of horsemanship. It was one of my earlier lessons, so it would have been, I would say, in the first week, maybe even, certainly in the first 2 weeks. So go check that out. Lots of great information for you there, Melanie. And you know what? Here's the truth. I know hundreds of riders who have overcome a horrible, paralyzing fear of riding or horses by following these step-by-step processes and by working on it. But the deal is, nobody gives that to you. You must build your confidence by systematically working on it. And so you'll have to take some responsibility for that. But there's lots of great resources for you there on my website, juliegoodnight.com. Also, I encourage you to check out Barbara Schulte's website. I believe it's just barbaraschulte.com, but it's B-A-R-B-R-A, Barbara, and Schulte, S-C-H-U-L-T-E. It's just some fabulous materials on confidence building and fear. So, Elizabeth, temper. I know all about that with the yellow monster. I guess you do. You could have written a book on it. And Elizabeth is one of my interactive students. She's been an interactive student for some time. I've also had her and her horse in clinics, so I know them personally. I've come to know them personally. And we work through my interactive online program constantly. And her horse is a little, I nicknamed him, fondly nicknamed him the little yellow monster, because he can be a spoiled brat, and he's a lot like Woodrow, I think, where he's just opinionated and he does not like to be told what to do. And he's clever, so he learns bad things quickly, and through some bad handling he became a mess, didn't he, Elizabeth? Marianne, good to hear from you today, 2 days in a row. Lisa, Idaho Falls, I'm now letting my horses in the afternoon. Nice. Limited in the afternoon when you don't have that cold weather stress from the grass. That's important. So when we start turning our horses out to green grass, this is a little early yet for us. We live at almost 8,000 feet of altitude. So spring comes slowly. But when we start turning our horses out to grass, and by the way, if you go to the Nutramax Facebook page, Cosequin Equine, and I have written some meal plans on how I feed my horses and what my concerns are correlating to each summer of the year. I'm just working on the summer meal plan right now. But when we start turning our horses out to green grass, the first day I'm going to turn them out, I wait till the afternoon. I make sure they've had plenty of hay before they go out so they have full bellies. And we only let them stay out for an hour or two at the max before we bring them back in. We do that for a number of days before we start increasing the time they're going to graze. And then over the course of probably 2-3 weeks, we will work them up to grazing through the middle part of the day. But then we do bring them in because we bring them in at night, and they will have a pile of hay in front of them all night long, but they don't eat much after they've been eating green grass. I have trouble bringing them back in. Yes, here is where your grain comes in. So whenever we change our feeding routine, such as starting to turn the horses out to pasture, but for a limited amount, and they're very eager to go out to that green grass, so it's hard to get them back in. So what we do after an hour and a half, I want to bring them in. We have a whistle or a call, a certain call I do, I'll spare you the yelling, shake a can of grain. And some of them, even though they have full bellies on green grass, it only takes one or two horses in your herd that are cookie monsters. And they hear that grain can and they come running in, and you just give them a little, throw a little grain on the ground. They're only going to get like one bite. I try to make sure everybody that came in got a bite of grain. But they're only going to get one or two bites at the most, but it got them in. And it works every time. So every time, this is a way that we use positive reinforcement in our training to get a new routine going. So if I want to bring them in every day at 3:00, I want to stick to a schedule. Horses know the clock really well. And so the more of a routine we can make that new routine, the quicker they'll learn it. So same time every day, going to go out there. I'm going to do the same whistle or the same call. Shake that can of grain till I get the attention of one horse, and then there's usually a jealousy thing going on, so they all come running in. We shut the gates, make sure every horse has a little bit of a bite of grain. Within 2 or 3 days, that's a new routine, and they're coming in looking for their grain whether you call them or not. So that's what we do. There's training horse. I know that's a hard situation because you're bringing them off of the green grass. But if you use a little bit of a food-based reward for that, a little grain, they'll be happy to get it. It's a thought that counts for them. So, free shipping for the rest of the month. Thank you. Daryl Nephew. Hey, Daryl Nephew from Circle Y. Good to hear from you. What am I doing? Well, you got it. I have been quite busy during this shutdown. We've been doing video production every single day, and I've been doing more video production than you guys have actually even been seeing, because we've been doing stuff for our sponsors as well. Working on a great saddle fitting series with our partners at Circle Y. By the way, Mr. Daryl Nephew, we're selling quite a few saddles these days. You guys are, this is the time of year where we sell a lot of saddles, and you're not letting that shutdown get you down. You know you're going to go back to riding. It's easy to social distance on a trail ride on a horse. So people are buying saddles. My Cascade saddle, my new hybrid trail saddle, selling like hotcakes because people love that 23-pound weight of that saddle, the comfort, and the way that it's tricked out for trail. So, okay, Idaho. Virginia, Huntington Beach. Good morning, cute top. Thank you. One of my latest acquisitions from the Denver airport, actually, I buy most of my clothes at the Denver airport, which has fabulous shopping. And because I used to spend a lot of time there and I hate shopping otherwise, I buy a lot of clothes there. And this was something I bought recently there. Thanks for noticing, Susie. Good morning, Joan. Kimber from Texas. Hey, Kimber from Texas. Hey, you guys, a lot of you have been on every single live post that I've done, and you're kind of getting to know each other, aren't you? Is there an official Julie Goodnight lunge line available? You know, no, is the answer to that. We have 15-foot training leads. They're heavy leads made of marine rope for groundwork training. We use them for the circling work. But a lunge line is going to be 25 feet long. And so you want a lightweight webbing or something for that. I don't really, to be honest, use lunge lines very much. I have several that I don't use. So I'll send you one. My Yucca City, Florida. Hello. Okay, Terry. My horse threw a tantrum yesterday, too. First time this spring with taking him out for groundwork, I have created a monster. I am putting him on the round pen for a while today. Maybe get some spring energy out before I try again on the groundwork. Yeah, look, if your horse has not been messed with for a while, I would not expect much of him the first day. I would really focus on very basic ideas. Let me remind you, horse, that I call the shots. Let me remind you, horse, that sometimes you will have to stand here tied up patiently. Let me remind you, horse, that when I lead you, there's a certain way you have to act in a certain place you need to be. Let me remind you how we do this groundwork. Certainly, if you have a horse that is not well trained, or he's a young green horse, or he's had bad handling in the past, you might want to start with round pen work with that horse. The nice thing about the round pen is there's more psychology going on in the round pen. We're moving that horse around at liberty so we can get a little bit more gas out of the tank that way. If I've got a horse that's really full of himself and maybe he hasn't been separated from the herd in a while, so I've got that dynamic going on. He's calling out. He's frantic, throwing a fit about being separated from the herd, which is likely why your horse was throwing a temper tantrum. I would probably put him in the round pen, let him get his yah-yahs out there. But I would try to keep his ire down. I would try to get him back into the frame of mind of listening to me, responding to me, obeying my commands that he already knows. But no matter what your horse situation, if you have not ridden him or worked him in a while, I wouldn't expect much of him that first couple of days. Just think about reconnecting and reestablishing at the same place you were where you left off. That would be my entire focus for a while. So, yes, so go to the round pen. And then, you know, the thing about your lead line work is this is stuff you do every single day with your horse. When you come in and out of the barn, when you lead him to the arena, when you lead him to the round pen, when you lead him back, all of those are training opportunities. Don't just focus on how your horse responds in the moment you're officially doing the groundwork. These are expectations of a behavior that you should have of your horse at all times you are around him. So I see so often people, you know, go to the round pen to work their horse, or they go in the arena and do all the fancy stuff. And then in their just regular day-to-day going back and forth from the barn, handling of the horse, they let them get away with bloody murder. So that consistency of leadership must be present throughout all of the handling you do with your horse, whether he's been laid off for some time or not. Mares seemed to get a bad rap. I had my mare spayed at CSU. Cool. Made a big difference. No more heat cycles and more mellow. It will not fix all behaviors, but it was very worth it. Absolutely, Diane. I've heard that again and again from mare owners that have had their mares spayed, and they did a great deal of the research on spaying mares was done at CSU, so you're fortunate to have great access to veterinary care. But it's much more routine now, and less invasive than it was originally. And a lot of horse owners have had good success from spaying mares. Look, it doesn't solve every problem, but I like to remind people that geldings are neutered and mares are not. So it's unfair to compare mares and geldings in straight across the board. But so spaying a mare really works. It's amazing. Good morning, Pat. The indirect rein lesson worked. Excellent. I'm so glad you got a good feel of it, and I hope other people did. Now, the indirect rein is in the best of circumstances, if I was right there in the arena with you, the indirect rein is difficult to teach because everybody wants to pull on it. And the indirect rein is a very soft movement. It is more a repositioning of your hand. And if you pull on it at all, it doesn't work. And so I was my main concern in doing the daily dose lesson on the indirect rein in front of the withers, I guess I did both the in front of and behind, so we moved the shoulder and the hip, was not being able to be there to correct you when you try it. So just remember, everybody, the way you use your hands in those indirect reins are very specific and very subtle, and never involve heavy contact on the rein. If you're going to heavy contact, you're not doing it right. And when you do it right, the horse always responds correctly. So it's a cool thing. I'm glad you like that, Patty. So recommendation for building top line. Sure. Well, I'll tell you what I would do. I'd make sure the horse is on a really good nutritional program, and I'm not going to be the one to give you that advice. Like I said, Dr. Getty would be someone I would contact, but do the research or consult an equine nutritionist in order to make sure your horse is getting a good, adequate diet for building muscle. Because without that, you can do a lot of work, but he's not really getting the protein levels, iron levels, and all that. He needs to actually build muscle. So the top line we're talking about along the spine of the horse from the withers to the tail. As horses age, their abdominal muscles get soft. As horses age, people too, their abdominal muscles get soft and their back starts lowering down. They start arching the back. Or if a horse has, been inadequately fed, and he's been malnourished and the muscles have just gone away. And so you see the spine of the horse sticking up and the muscles are dropping away instead of the opposite, the muscles bulging up above the spine of the horse. So when we talk about building top line, we're talking about building that musculature that encases both sides of the spine and getting that horse to engage his hind end and work his hind end and back muscles. In doing that, he has to tighten and engage his abdominal muscles. So what I use is my bidding system, and it is a bidding system called an elbow pull. And I have a video on the subject, as well as the actual piece of tack that you use. But it's kind of difficult to explain in this format. But I use the bidding rig because it causes the horse to come into a rounded, collected frame to engage his abdominal muscles and lift his back. But he holds himself there without contact on his mouth. So I am not a fan of draw reins and side reins to get a horse to engage his hindquarters, because I think it creates a false frame on the horse. And in the case of side reins, it causes him to lean on the reins. So with my bidding system, he rounds up and he holds himself there, because in holding himself there, he finds a release of pressure from his mouth. And so we work that horse for about 10 minutes a day, 5 days a week. in the bidding rig for about 30 days and you'll see a tremendous difference. But your nutritional campaign is going to be a big, big part of that as well. So good luck with that. How do you get information on scheduling me for a clinic? You may contact email Twyla, T-W-Y-L-A, at juliegoodnight.com. You could call my office and speak to Diana. That number is 719-530-0531. Or you could send an email to Diana at diana@juliegoodnight.com. I believe we have information on my website as well. I just don't exactly know the link to it, but I'm sure Diana will put that up. Look, I do clinics different ways, and I sometimes I work on a flat fee basis. You hire me to come in and do a clinic, anywhere from 1 to 20 people. I don't care. You're paying a flat fee. You charge what you want for the clinic. Or sometimes we organize the clinic and do all that work ourselves and rent a facility. Either way, we have to have some sort of access to that facility. So contact my office. How do you slow the horse when offloading from a straight load trailer? He backs off in a heightened state. Yeah. Great question, Teresa. So as it turns out, a lot of people have trouble getting their horse into the trailer. And then a whole lot of other people have trouble getting their horse out of the trailer. Sometimes they won't go back at all. And sometimes when they do go back, they fly backwards. So here's what I would do. I would try to find a trailer you can practice in that is, to me, the perfect trailer for practicing loading and unloading is a four-horse stock trailer because it's open and it's long. And so that horse can learn to back out slowly one step at a time before he has to step off the ledge. Horses are frightened about backing out of the trailer because there is no situation in nature where a horse would step down a step. In fact, in nature, really the only time he would back up would be if he was kicking double barrels at another horse. You don't look out into a pasture full of horses and see them backing up. And so, unless they're kicking something. So that idea of stepping down, first of all, backwards, is untenable to many, many horses. It feels like they're stepping off a cliff. And it is, they're stepping into their blind spot. So what I want to do with that horse that's afraid to step back out of the trailer, I load them in a stock trailer first so that I can turn them around and let them walk out forward many, many times. So we'll walk on that trailer, get a little bite of grain, turn around, walk off, walk on, walk off, walk on, and walk off forward until he sort of understands what he's doing. He's still not going to want to step down a step backwards. So then what I'll start doing is I'll load him up into that stock trailer. I'll back him one step, pet him, maybe stop him, pet him, maybe give him a little bite of grain, pet him, one step, stop, pet him, one step, stop, pet him. And then when I get right to the edge, I'll turn him around forward and let him walk back. And I'll do that a number of times until he's backing all the way to the edge, and then I let him turn around and walk out. And then at some point when he's doing all of that quietly, I will ask him to go ahead and step down a step. He won't like it. He'll jump back in the trailer. We'll go back and forth a couple times, but eventually he'll get it and he'll put all that together. Now let me tell you what not to do when a horse is wanting to back rapidly or pull back. The worst thing you can do is try to pull him towards you. The more you pull him towards you, the faster back he's going to go. So we need to teach that horse to back properly from the ground outside of the trailer situation to where you can control him backing one step at a time and then bring those skills back to the trailer. By the way, we did an episode of Horse Master on that very subject. It was a mature, well-trained horse that had always been allowed to turn around and walk out forward, and he just flat out refused to step down the trailer. And it wasn't that he was backing out too fast, actually. It was that he was wouldn't back out, period. And anyway, those are some things that might help. Episode on Horsemaster. For those of you that are members on our website and have the full training library subscription, you've got hundreds and hundreds of videos, and many of those are on trailer loading and also trailer unloading. So good luck with that. Okay, Lillian, glad to see you. Checking in from New York. Teaching a green horse to canter under saddle. You know, look, I just wait until I feel like that horse is ready and all situation is good. You know, all the lights are green and I just urge that horse up into a canter by sort of pumping with my seat like I'm pushing a swing. Maybe give him a little kiss. So when I feel like maybe he's thinking about cantering or wants to canter or just that now might be a good time, I just urge him up into a canter. Let that green horse go a little bit faster than you think. They don't know how to canter slowly. It's going to be some time. I'll just urge him up to a canter. Go 8 or 10 strides. Come back to a trot. Trot around for a little while. Go back, review some things the horse knows how to do well, and then urge him up into a canter again. Shouldn't be a big deal. A great place to canter a horse for the first time, if the situation is right, is out on the trail with other horses that are well-trained. Preferably if I could have a slight incline, so the horse is actually having to work pretty hard at the canter. And I'll just kind of orchestrate that we all go up to the canter together, let that horse learn to balance a rider at the canter with the comfort of the herd around him. And then we'll come back and work on cues and stuff like that, controlling the canter in the arena later. So, just had a horse at grass foundered. Absolutely. I know that's a difficult challenge for you on managing the grass. So, hello from France, Lucy. Hope you guys are seeing the other side of this over there in France these days. Sounds like things are maybe starting to stabilize, hopefully. Yeah, I've posted lots of Dr. Getty's articles on my website. Thank you, Diana. Would love to come down to North Carolina, my old stomping ground. I started college. My first year of college was in North Carolina at UNC Asheville. Terry in Wyoming, it's a beautiful day. No wind, woohoo! Wow, no wind in Wyoming is really something. Look, I've been to Wyoming a lot. I'm not sure I've ever been there when the wind isn't blowing. Okay. Good morning, Caroline. How much of ribs should you be able to feel in fitness? There's probably a good answer to that, and I hesitate to say because I fear I would go against the, you know, standard. But, you should be able to feel a horse's ribs for sure. If he's got so much fat on his ribs you can't even feel his ribs, he's a fat horse. So when I start getting concerned about fat is when I'm seeing pockets of fat on the crest of the neck, pockets of fat around the wither, and pockets of fat around the dock of the tail. If you're seeing hand-sized pockets of fat in those areas, you have an obesity problem. When I say our horses get fat in the summer on the green grass, they don't get that fat. so that's that horse overeating over a long period of time, and probably a horse that needs to actually have his nutrition analyzed. What is he getting that's high calorie in his diet that we could cut out? And sometimes that's actually coming from the hay. So hay can be very high sugar content, high protein content, so you have to be careful there. good morning from New Mexico. Lori from Wisconsin. Your daily dose is a lifesaver during this stay-at-home time. Julius Thompson advice for all things equine. Ride with you if you're able. Thank you so much. Okay, let's see. Having a hard time finding a cinch for a Pasifino mare. She is sensitive. Can you say when you choose between the two you offer on site? Okay. So, you know, different cinches are different depending on the horse I'm using them on, how you're using that horse. And I'll tell you, there's no, it's hard to say you should always use this kind of cinch and never use that kind, because the situations vary so much. For instance, I'm not a big fan of neoprene girths. However, many people are, because they're very, very easy to keep clean. And that can be a big problem for horse trainers that are switching tack between a number of horses, and they're trying to control, you know, girth itch and fungal infections between horses. So that neoprene closed-cell saddle pads and closed-cell cinches are really easy to keep clean. And so if cleanliness is my number one concern, that would be the cinch I would use. However, we don't use them on horses that are going to be saddled all day. If you have a horse that you're going to be riding and then maybe letting him cool off and then riding harder and then letting him cool off, like a trail horse or a ranch horse, or maybe I'm at a clinic or a horse show, he's going to sweat under that neoprene cinch a lot, and then that sweat is going to dry, and then when you go to start working him again, it's going to be uncomfortable. So in that setting, the neoprene cinch doesn't work. I want to use a cinch that absorbs sweat. I like, you know, natural products, so I'm looking for that natural wool felt or that natural wool fleece. So, and then mohair is fine. You want a well-braided, a lot of strands in the mohair. A wider cinch is going to be more comfortable for the horse than a narrow cinch. The type of saddle that you use will often dictate, not necessarily the material of that cinch, but the size of the cinch, and might dictate some cinches you don't want to use. So, sorry, it's hard to answer that question very specifically, and but I think all of those things can be a factor, and certainly size matters. And so with a Pasofino, I thought you were going to say you were having trouble finding a cinch to go small enough. Which can also be a problem, especially if you have a saddle with drop-down rigging, as my saddles have. You have to go to a smaller cinch on that. So between the two I offer on my site, I'd have to look at, and I can't remember which two those are. We actually have more cinches than what we have on the site, apparently. Vicky, is Mylar combination bit good for trail riding? Absolutely. I'd say that's one of the best uses for it. The combination bit combines a hackamore and a bit. It is highly, highly comfortable for the horse because you use very, very little mouth contact. Also, we like the hackamore situations on the trail horses because they can eat and drink better. In this case, your horse still has a bit in his mouth. But the way it suspends in the mouth might make it a little bit easier for him to eat and drink with. However, the great thing about the Mylar combination bit is it gives you excellent control with the least amount of stress level on your horse. So a lot of people that have spooky horses or hot-blooded horses that they're trail riding have gone to the Mylar combination bit because they feel a greater sense of control, better stopping power, but you're not going to a stronger bit, or harsher bit that would also increase the anxiety of the horse, so you ultimately end up with less control. So this is kind of a weird situation on bits. Also, if you go to my website and go to the I believe maybe Diana, you can throw up a link to the page that has all the information on the Mylar bits that I use, why I use them, what type of horse I use them on, and why. There's also a link to Dale Mylar's bidding questionnaire. So if you want to know what the best bit to use for your horse is, you can fill out that questionnaire and he will review it and make a recommendation for you. And sometimes he says, I don't think you should change. He's very honest and straightforward about those recommendations. So I encourage you to get more information there, and also to fill out that bidding questionnaire. How do you feel about bitless? Well, I get this question a lot, of course. We ride our horses are trained to ultimately ride without a bridle at all. No halter, no nothing. No reins, no nothing. So I believe that a well-trained horse does not need a bit in their mouth, but I believe you probably needed the bit in the mouth to get them well-trained. I believe most well-trained horses could be ridden easily in a rope halter as easily as they can in the bit, but often we need that bit to get the horse to the well-trained level. So when it comes to riding bitless, there are all kinds of bridles that fall into that category. So you have a bosal, a side pull, a rope halter, a mechanical hackamore, a cross under bridle, and now I've seen some other kind of bitless bridles on the market. I'm not a big fan of the cross under, I'll have to tell you. I think it tends to make horses heavy and lean and drop their shoulder. But a well-trained horse can ride in anything. Now, when people ask me, do you think it's okay for me to ride my horse bitless? I say, it depends on how you answer these two questions. Number one, what does your horse do when he spooks? Now notice I didn't say, does your horse spook? I said, what does he do when he spooks? Because all horses spook in some situations, some way more than others. But some horses just spook by, you know, doing the old quarter horse spook where they splay all four feet and just stand there. And other horses spin and bolt. If I'm riding a horse that spins and bolts, I'm going to put a bit in his mouth. So the second question that I ask when people say, is it okay to ride my horse without a bit? Is, can you stop the horse 100% of the time? And if there's any hesitation in your answer, I would question the use of a bitless bridle. Now look, if you're just riding in an arena in a very controlled environment that your horse has been in, you know, for years and every day and it's no big deal, fine. But if you're going out on the trail in an uncontrolled environment where spooking could potentially happen and it could be hazardous, I want the ability to stop my horse in an emergency. And whether we like the thought of it or not, bits were designed to equalize the flight response on the horse. Bits were originally designed to give us the ability to stop a bolting horse. But that's only if you know how to do it. So even if you know how to stop a runaway horse, which is what I just did a lesson on with the pulley rein, you have to be able to execute that very difficult rein maneuver while the horse is running away with you. And if you know how to do it, you can stop that horse. So whether or not you ride without a bit depends entirely on how well-trained that horse is, how spooky he is, how easy he is to stop, and what sort of environment you're riding in. So safety is the number one concern. Also, the other thing that bits allow you to do is to use an appropriate amount of pressure to motivate horses to do difficult things that he might not otherwise do if you didn't have an ability to motivate him. It gives you the ability to find the amount of pressure that motivates change. And when we ask our horse to do very high level maneuvers, it's difficult for them. And that is why it is questionable if we can actually get the horse trained to the highest levels without a bit in his mouth. I'm not saying you cannot do it. I believe very strongly it could be done. I just don't think it'd be easy. It's not easy even with a bit. So that's that. Susie, go slow read as you, the injured party, was the best advice I got. Go slowly. Absolutely. Looks like I'm in a camper. No, I'm not. Okay, let's see if I thought I was getting down to IR horses. IR, you know, I feel like I should know what that means. IR horses, but I don't. So give me a hint there. Norma, we thought we're the only ones that wait until May to turn them out. Okay, am I okay? Yeah, sorry. Just talking continuously. Sometimes my throat gets a little dry. I'm fine. Actually, I just had my annual checkup yesterday with my physician through telemedicine. It was great. My new favorite way to get a checkup, I can tell you that. We had a fabulous conversation, and he asked me and reviewed everything, and it was all good. And so now I have completed my New Year's resolution, at least part of it. I didn't even have to go to the doctor. Okay, and Vermont, hello. Hot toddy with honey and lemon. That is a little too early in the day for me for that. No, I just a little drink of water is all I need. And to not talk so much. Manhattan, Kansas, good evening from sunny UK. Thank you guys for joining us from Europe. Today, we're not getting too much communication from down under today. We have a few far-off people in the east, so I wish you had bridles in the beautiful colors. So you can purchase matching headstalls for all the saddles that we sell, and in all three colors, walnut, natural oil, or black. And so it's just a matter of ordering them. When we sell saddles, we really encourage people to buy the matching tack at the same time. That way it's probably made from the same hide of leather, and it's certainly processed at the same time so that the matching colors are really good. It will still match if it's not made at the same time, but one reason we really encourage people to buy the matching tack is because of how often when you don't buy it, you come back a few weeks later, a month later, and wish you had bought it. So we just know from experience you're going to regret that decision. The good news is, because of our points program, our loyalty programs for our customers, you actually earn dollars off. When you purchase a saddle, you're going to get about $75, $85 off on your next purchase. So a lot of that tackle actually end up getting being paid for. So how great is that? Okay, let me scroll down here. How high should tie rings be from the ground? Great question, Lisa. So again, people tie up horses in so many different configurations, from cross ties to straight ties to ground tie to hitch and rails to patience post, whatever. Here's the bottom line, and this is something that I have to give a shout out to the Certified Horsemanship Association. We are a nonprofit organization that promotes safety and effectiveness in horsemanship. And first and foremost, we are a safety-based organization. And so when you have questions like this, what's the best way to do this? What's the best way to do that? CHA is a great resource of information. Their website is chainstructors.com, or you can go to cha.horse. And they have a YouTube channel with all kinds of educational information. But here's what is in the composite manual of horsemanship when it comes to tying horses, that they should always be tied at or above wither height. And I would say at is a little bit low for me. I want to be above wither height, and we want enough lead to where the horse can hold his head and neck comfortably. In some situations, we want to have enough slack in the lead that they can touch their nose to the ground so they could eat from a pile of hay if they were tied for a long period of time. But no more than that. And the reason we want to tie them high is to prevent the horse from getting a front foot over the rope. So good question. Thank you. Please don't cough in your hand or wipe your nose with your hand. Okay. Well, I'm all by myself here, and I will go wash my hands afterwards. Okay. I have made it to the bottom of your questions in only an hour and 15 minutes. So by the way, tomorrow I'm going to come back at you live with another post, but it will be actually at 11 a.m. Mountain Time. That's 1 p.m. on the East Coast. That is 10 a.m. on the West Coast and 11 a.m. Mountain Time. So I hope you guys will join me then. I'm going to actually have a living room lesson for you tomorrow. So I want you to put on some comfortable clothes, push back the furniture so you can sit on the floor, stand up, move around a little bit. Join me tomorrow for another Facebook Live. Thank you guys for asking great questions, and thank you for being a part of the Daily Dose of Horsemanship Homework. Be sure you stay safe and stay smart. I'm Julie Goodnight. My website is juliegoodnight.com. Be sure to check it out. Thank you guys for joining me. I'll come back at you again tomorrow for another Facebook Live at 1 p.m. Eastern Time. Thanks for joining me.